Hi guys, welcome back. This is going to be part 2 of Thumbelina. If you like, please like. If you've enjoyed, please subscribe. And well, let's get on to it. But Tiny did not feel at all interested about the neighbor, for he was a mole. However, he came and paid his visits dressed in a black velvet cloak. He is very rich and learned, and the house is 20 times larger than mine, said the field mouse. He was learned and rich, no doubt, but he always spoke slightly of the sun and the pretty flowers because he had never seen them. Tiny was obligated to sing to him, "Ladybug, ladybug, fly away home," and many other pretty songs, and the mole fell in love with her because she had such a sweet voice. But he said nothing yet, for he was very cautious. A short time before, the mole had dug a long passage under the earth, which led from the dwelling of the field mouse to his own, and when here she had permission to walk with Tiny whenever she liked. But he warned them not to be alarmed at the sight of a dead bird, which lay in the passage. It was a perfect bird, with a beak and feathers, and could not have been dead long, and was lying just where the mole had made his passage. The mole took a piece of fluorescent wood in his mouth, and it glittered like fire in the dark. Then he went before them to light them through the long, dark passage. When they came to the spot where lay the dead bird, the mole pushed his broad nose through the ceiling, and the earth gave away so that there was a large hole, and the daylight shone into the passage. In the middle of the floor lay a dead swallow, his beautiful wings pulled close to his side, his feet and his head drawn up together under his feathers, and the poor bird had evidently died of the cold. It made Tiny very sad to see it. She did so love the little birds all the summer. They had sung and twittered for her so beautifully. But the mole pushed it aside with his crooked legs and said, "He will sing no more. How miserable it must be to be born with a little bird. I am thankful that none of my children will ever be birds, for they can do nothing but cry, tweet, tweet, and always die of hunger in the winter." "Yes, you may well say that a clever man," exclaimed the field mouse. "What is the use of his twittering, for when winter comes, he must either starve or be frozen to death. Still, birds are very high-bred." Tiny said nothing. But when the two others had turned their backs on the bird, she stooped down and stroked aside the soft feathers which covered the head and kissed the closed eyelids. "Perhaps this is the one who sang to me so sweetly in the summer," she said, "and how much pleasure it gave me, you dear pretty bird." The mole now stopped up the hole through which the daylight shone, and then accompanied the lady home. But during the night, Tiny could not sleep, so she got out of bed and wove a large, beautiful carpet of hay. Then she carried it to the dead bird and spread it over him with some down from the flowers which she had found in the field mouse room. It was as soft as wool, and she spread some of it on each side of the bird so that he might lie warmly in the cold earth. "Farewell, you pretty little bird," said she. "Farewell. Thank you for your delightful singing during the summer when all the trees were green and the warm sun shone upon us." Then, as she laid her head on the bird's breast, but she was alarmed immediately, for it seemed as though something in the bird went thump, thump. It was the bird's heart. He was not really dead, only benumbed with the cold, and the warmth had restored him to life. In autumn, all the swallows fly away into warm countries, but if one happens to linger, the cold seizes it. It becomes frozen and falls down as if dead. It remains where it fell, and the cold snow covers it. Tiny trembled very much. She was quite frightened, for the bird was large and a great deal larger than herself. She was only an inch high, but she took courage, laid the wool more thickly over the poor swallow, and then took a leaf that she had used for her own counterpane. She laid it over the head of the poor bird. The next morning she again stole out to see him. He was alive, but very weak. He could only open his eyes for a moment to look at Tiny, who stood by holding a piece of decayed wood in her hand, for she had no other lantern. "Thank you, pretty little maiden," said the sick swallow. "I have been so nicely warmed that I shall soon regain my strength and be able to fly about again in the warm sunshine." "Oh," said she, "it is cold outdoors now, and snows and freezes. Stay in your warm bed. I will take care of you." Then she brought the swallow some water and a flower leaf, and after he had a drink, he told her that he had wounded one of his wings in a thorn bush and could not fly as fast as the others, who were soon far away on their journey to warm countries. Then at last he had fallen to the earth and could remember no more, nor how he came to be when she had found him. The whole winter the swallow remained underground, and Tiny nursed him with care and love. Neither the mole nor the field mouse knew anything about it, for they did not like swallows. Very soon the spring time came. And the sun warmed the earth. Then the swallow bade farewell to Tiny, and she opened the hole in the ceiling which the mole had made. The sun shone in upon them so beautifully that the swallow asked her if she would go with him. She could sit on his back, he said, and he would fly away with her into the green woods. But Tiny knew it would make the field mouse very grieved if she left in that manner, so she said, "No, I cannot." "Farewell, then, farewell, you good, pretty little maiden," said the swallow, and he flew out into the sunshine. Tiny looked after him, and the tears rose in her eyes. She was very fond of that poor swallow. "Tweet, tweet," sang the bird as he flew out into the green woods, and Tiny felt very sad. She was not allowed to go out into the warm sunshine. The corn which had been sown into the field over the house of the field mouse had grown up high into the air and formed a thick wood to Tiny, who was only an inch in height. "You are going to be married, Tiny," said the field mouse. "My neighbor has asked for you. What good fortune for a poor child like you. Now we will prepare your wedding clothes. They must be both woolen and linen. Nothing must be wanting when you are a mole's wife." Tiny had to turn the spindle, and the field mouse hired 4 spiders who were to weave day and night. Every evening the mole visited her and was continually speaking of the time when the summer would be over. Then he would keep his wedding day with Tiny. But now the heat of the sun was so great that it burned the earth and made it quite hard like a stone. As soon as the summer was over, the wedding should take place, but Tiny was not at all pleased, for she did not like the tiresome mole. Every morning when the sun rose and every evening when it went down, she would creep out the door, and as the wind blew aside the ears of corn so that she could see the blue sky, she thought how beautiful and bright it seemed out there and wished so much to see the dear swallow again. But he never returned, for by the time he had flown far away into the lovely green forest. When autumn arrived, Tiny had her outfit quite ready, and the field mouse said to her, "In 4 weeks the wedding must take place." Then Tiny wept and said she would not marry the disagreeable mole. "Nonsense," replied the field mouse. "Now don't be obstinate, or I shall bite you with my white teeth. He is a very handsome mole. The queen herself does not wear more beautiful velvets and furs. His kitchens and cellars are quite full. You ought to be very thankful for such good fortune." So the wedding day was fixed on, for which the mole was to fetch Tiny away to live with him deep under the earth, and never again see the warm sun, because he did not like it. The poor child was very unhappy at the thought of saying farewell to the beautiful sun, and as the field mouse had given her permission to stand at the door, she went to look at it once more. "Farewell, bright sun," she cried, stretching out her arms toward it and then walking a short distance from the house, for the corn had been cut and only the dry stubble remained in the fields. "Farewell, farewell," she repeated, winding her arms around a little red flower that grew just by her side. "Greet the little swallow for me, if you should ever see him again." "Tweet, tweet," sounded over her head suddenly. She looked up, and there was the swallow himself flying close by. As soon as he spied Tiny, he was delighted, and then she told him how unwillingly she felt to marry the ugly mole and to live always beneath the earth, never to see the bright sun anymore. And as she told him, she wept. "Cold winter is coming," said the swallow, "and I'm going to fly away into warmer countries. Will you go with me? You can sit on my back and fasten yourself on with your sash. Then you can fly away from that ugly mole and his gloomy rooms, far away over the mountains into the warmer countries, where the sun shines more brightly, where it is always summer, and the flowers bloom in greater beauty. Fly now with me, dear little Tiny. You saved my life when I lay frozen in that dark passage." "Yes, yes, I will go with you, said Tiny, and she seated herself on the bird's back with her feet on his outstretched wings and tied her girdle to one of his strongest feathers. Then the swallow rose in the air and flew over forest and over sea, high above the highest mountains covered with eternal snow. Tiny would have been frozen in the cold air, but she crept under the bird's warm feathers, keeping her little head uncovered so that she might admire the beautiful lands over which they passed. At length, they reached the warm countries, where the sun shines brightly and the sky seems so much higher above the earth. Here on the hedge and by the wayside grew purple, green, and white grapes. Lemons and oranges hung from trees in the woods, and the air was fragrant with myrtles and orange blossoms. Beautiful children ran along the country lanes, playing with large butterflies, and as the swallow flew farther and farther, every place appeared still more lovely. At last, they came into a blue lake, and by the side of it, shaded by trees of the deepest green, stood a palace of dazzling white marble built in olden times. Vines clustered around its lofty pillars, and at the top were many swallows' nests, and one of those was the home of the swallow who carried Tiny. This is my house, said the swallow, but it would not do for you to live here. You would not be comfortable. You must choose for yourself one of those lovely flowers, and I will put you down upon it, and then you shall have everything that you can wish to make you happy. That will be delightful, she said, and clapped her little hands for joy. A large marble pillar lay on the ground, which in falling had been broken into three pieces. Between these pieces grew the most beautiful large white flower. So the swallow flew down with Tiny and placed her on one of the broad leaves. But how surprised she was to see in the middle of the flower a tiny little man, as white and as transparent as if he was made of crystal. He had a gold crown on his head and delicate wings at his shoulders, and not so much larger than Tiny herself. He was the angel of the flower, for a tiny man and a tiny woman dwell in every flower. But this one, he was the king of them all. Oh, how beautiful he is, whispered Tiny to the swallow. The little prince, who was at first quite frightened at the bird, who was giant compared to such a delicate little creature as himself, but when he saw Tiny, he was delighted and thought her the prettiest little maiden he had ever seen. He took the gold crown from his head and placed it on hers and asked her name and if she would be his wife and queen over all flowers. This certainly was a very different sort of husband to a son of a toad or the mole with black velvet and fur, so she said yes to the handsome prince. Then all the flowers opened, and out of them each came a little lady and a tiny lord, all so pretty. It was quite a pleasure to look at them. Each of them brought Tiny a present, but the best gift was a pair of beautiful wings which had belonged to a large white fly, and they fastened them to Tiny's shoulders so that she might fly from flower to flower. Then there was much rejoicing, and the little swallow who sat above them in his nest was asked to sing a wedding song, which he did as well as he could, but in his heart he felt sad, for he was very fond of Tiny and would have liked never to part from her again. You must not be called Tiny anymore, said the spirit of the flower to her. It is an ugly name, and you are so very pretty. We will call you Maya. Farewell. Farewell, said the swallow with a heavy heart as he left the warm countries to fly back into Denmark. There he had a nest over the window of a house in which dwelt the writer of fairy tales. The swallow sang tweet tweet, and from his song came the whole story.